Felicia Michaels, my you princess, voice, you has been entertaining audiences with a unique
Joey
style
Coco Diaz has of been broccoli humor since the 90s, all right? Years.
With her tongue in cheek,
films and
she's been exploring such
but
topics of the dynamics of the male-female relationships, or as we call them here in the studio, dirty thoughts, and the proliferation of the sensual feminist. She's a little firecracker rolled up, and that's why I love her, and that's why you're going to love listening. So tune in, all right?
You know what's really awesome? We've been doing the podcast in August, late August, it'll be a year.
A year.
And it's just now where I figured something out on GarageBand that was so simple, like I feel like an idiot, you know? Because, you know, the cursor when you're talking is moving, right? But I couldn't figure out how to make it, like, move with the screen at the same time. And you just put this little arrow, and it was fixing. It was driving Danielle crazy. Speaking of, because you were just asking if we have spoken to Danielle Stewart lately. And she was like, that's crazy. It doesn't do that. And I couldn't figure it out. And I finally figured it out.
You know, it's funny because I did this thing and I got these cameras. I got a blogger camera from Sony. A really cute camera. And I am just, when it comes to all that stuff, I am fucking illiterate, you know. But my wife sat me down the other day and she goes, with these stuff, it's like anything else. It's a muscle. You have to just use it. Take the camera out once a day and just use it. And after it's filled up, we'll put it online. And she goes, let me show you what you could do with what I got you. And she set this whole program up. And you has a camera, and I can actually tape myself on the computer. And I don't know what it's called. And people at home are like, you're a fucking idiot. My computer does that. But I didn't know this shit.
Right,
so
right.
You feed this camera tape in.
Uh-huh.
So I can narrate the scenes as I'm talking about them. Like, I could do like a punk. You know what I'm saying? Like, I could not a punk, but I could like come to Felicia's to do the podcast. And then while we're doing it, put the camera over there, tape it. And then that night go home, download it. And then on that program she got me, say, this is what happened, went to Felicia's. Watch Felicia's face when I talk about burning the hooker's wig, you know, and it could go right to that. It was pretty neat. Then it has another button that says music. So please come over because I want you to look at this.
Oh, I
want to
look at this.
Yeah, I don't know. And you know what? It's something that's simple, and I just don't know how to explain it right. Like, people at home going, you're a fucking fat fucking Momo Joey. That's called this. I don't know. So that just goes to show you that I am blown away. I am intimidated by it because I always feel like I'm going to break something. You know,
right.
Like, I'm not trusted with that shit alone.
Yeah. Well, it is a thing where you have to do it every day. Like
every day.
When I didn't do comedy for a long time, my dark period, and I was pursuing photography because all chicks do eventually. And I worked at this place that was an image capturing firm, and it was one of the first ones here on the West Coast. And I would have to learn tasks, really complicated tasks, to do for one day, and then I wouldn't have to do that task again for 2 weeks later, like, you know, a specific computer task. And you would forget, because if you're not doing it every day, you fucking forget.
But if you do it every day, it becomes secondhand, and you make a mess. You could add music, and it would probably be like if I shot videos, like 3 videos a day, I could probably cut. I mean, that's how fast it was.
Right.
You just cut. You just roll the thing. Uh-huh. It cuts it. Press a button. Enter.
Doom. Well, I would like to see
that. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. So I really want to pursue that. You know, it's something that I just hate. Anything in life. Like, we always are scared of the thing that's going to bring us the most pleasure in a way. Like with MMA. And I got to use this as, like, right now in today's MMA world, all these wrestlers are coming in. So you got to learn how to fight on your back. And I got a lot of guys who go in there and get on their back, but to really learn how to attack on your back.
Women have known that trick for years,
right,
by the way.
It's so scary because you're on your fucking back.
Yeah.
So it eliminates another wall. It's the weirdest thing. For someone like me, you can't breathe. So a lot of people really don't put the effort into that. And some people do, and you can see it in their training. Well, the same thing goes with anything else in life. Like, I don't like needles. So I started going to acupuncture just because I didn't like needles. I wanted to get more comfortable with needles. So sometimes you have to face your fears. And believe it or not, that's one of my biggest fears, technology. Half the technology I don't think you need. I think it's just too much. We don't need this much. But that shit with those videos, that's fucking neat. That's why now all these kids do it.
Right,
that's
right.
Why
kids are
great at this shit.
Yeah.
You know, they're
absolutely
great at it.
Yeah.
They have the patience. They were brought up doing this shit. I mean, I couldn't even change a flat when I was a fucking kid. That's how much I could take the tire off. I could take the wheel off the bike. I could take the tire off. But I could never put the tube back in the fucking wheel to put it back on the bike. So I would just have a friend do that part of it.
Right.
And it was like, now I wish I could have my childhood again because I would do all these things that I avoided. You know, it's so weird. You just avoid this shit because you're a fucking Momo, you know, growing up.
No, I hear you. I hear you. And by the way, even if you think you know so much about computers, because I'm pretty savvy in a lot of ways with the computers, and then my girlfriend Wendy will come over and she's like, you don't know how to do that. And it's like the most simplest thing, like in mail, you know, and I'm like, really? You can do that?
I never knew about attachments on an email. Like, I never knew. Yeah, I never knew about you could send a headshot or a picture or something, or your bio. I thought it was this big fucking production, you know? And it's just really weird, the things that you look at and you're like, I'm not ever going to get involved with that. It's like editing the podcast. I don't think I could do it. Like, I'm petrified. I would break your fucking computer.
Oh, for you to edit the
podcast? Yeah, I would have to. I would break your computer. I'd have to come to you and go. And I always do.
You know, but you know, Joy, you could totally learn how to do it. But why would anyone want you to do that? You're so fabulous at other things.
But I like listening. I like listening to it. I like listening to it. You know, I like it. Listen, man, when you're an only child, and that's what really baffles me about the only child syndrome, that I have a lot of qualities from the only child, but the other only child syndrome I don't have. Like, when I told you, when I was a kid, I was nerdy. I built models. That was my thing. And a lot of, only, you know, you learn how to consume your own time. You learn how to fucking have a party in your head when you're by yourself and nobody to talk to. But it's like the things I thought I would naturally be good at. Like, I was shooting something yesterday and some kid came on the lot, a black kid. And I know he's a star from one of the shows, but I never really, I don't know his name.
Yeah.
And he was talking to one of the actors on the, and he goes, you know, when I'm not working, dog, all I do is work on computers. And the guy goes, what do you mean you work on computers? He goes, I'll take a computer and take that motherfucker apart and, you know, get back to the thing of it. And there's some people that are good at that.
Oh, yeah,
like, the only way, your brother, you had a brother who was a mechanic.
Yeah.
That was very inclined.
Yeah.
That motherfucker could take apart any engine and put it back together. And that's how you learn.
But when he put it back together, it wasn't quite right. There were two things missing.
But it's so weird how there's people who, my stepdad was a criminal.
Uh-huh.
But he could take a radio. Like, his whole thing was, oh, that radio doesn't work, Felicia. You're going to throw it away? Can I take it home? And then one day in the middle of the summer, he'd go downstairs, put a towel on the fucking table, get wrenches and his glasses, and just take apart a radio and put it back together. And all of a sudden, he'd be like, listen, come here. Oh, there'd be music playing.
Uh-huh.
And he'd be all excited that it's 1975, and he put together a radio that was big in 1948.
Uh-huh.
Like, that was his thing. But there's people that are good at that. I always thought I would be good at that. And I'm not.
Right.
Like, I just don't have, like, I like being by myself, but I don't think I have the confidence to take something apart and put it back together. I was good at puzzles as a kid.
Yeah.
But it just got to that one puzzle that you were like, fuck this shit. That one big one when you, and you did it too for a little while. And one day you just came home and says, why am I putting myself through all this drama? It's a fucking puzzle. I'm scared to come home because I know I got to work on this fucking puzzle. You know what I'm saying? We're back, bitches.
By the way, I wanted to tell you, speaking of puzzles, but I just watched this documentary on HBO about Bobby Fischer.
I watched the bits and pieces of it on DVR. So
you should watch it.
Yeah. I know the
really,
whole thing.
Really good.
Yeah, he's a fucking brilliant guy. He was a brilliant motherfucker.
I didn't realize, like, I knew him as the punchline of the Bobby Fischer, you know, the chess guy that went nutty. But, you know, but then when you see the documentary, I love a great documentary, but when you see a documentary where you're like, wow, I would have never thought of it from that point. Of course he went crazy. Of course this happened, you know.
Fucking chess
and it's
player
interesting.
On the streets. Yeah. HBO has a great way of doing documentaries. Even if you're not interested on the topic they're talking about.
Absolutely,
They're running one about John McEnroe now. You don't have to be a tennis buff to understand what the fuck was going on. They have one about the Bruins, about something street. That's interesting as shit. No matter, all their reports, real sports, you don't even have to like that sport.
Oh, I've seen a lot of the stuff off
and
that,
and you sit there, you know, the jockeys in India that don't, you know, just so many little things that you don't know about that's, I like when something informs you that you don't know about it. You thought you did know about it, but like this fucking computer we're talking about, you know?
Anyway, the fucking computer.
We're back, bitches. Beauty and the Beast podcast. Felicia Michaels.
Joey Diaz.
What's happening, you sexy animal?
Oh, Joey, I have been eating like a hog.
Good for you.
And
you're
when
recovering.
I say eating like a hog, I mean like ice cream four times a day. I'm like, I can't stop myself, you know?
You know, your post-surgery, you lost a little weight. The thing that's most interesting about this post-surgery is that they put you on sexual probation. And there's nothing worse than being put on probation for anything.
Oh, I know.
Because it's our instinct as children, and it's our instinct as comedians that we rebel. And when somebody says to you, you can't have sex, right away you look at them like your eyeballs blink, and you're like, whoa, no sex. And even if you're not a freak, it's just a time period now that they gave you, 6 weeks. And it's like, I can't explain it. With me, It was always, you can't do that. That would drive me crazy. Like, I don't give a fuck about not having sex for 6 weeks.
Really?
But for somebody to tell you,
hey,
you can't have sex for 6 weeks, that's completely different for people like us. Now we're trying to figure out how to get fucked from behind, like putting our dick in and not moving too much, or maybe there's a half an earthquake. You know what I'm saying? Because that's your nature. Not having sex for 6 weeks, you just live. You've done it before.
I've done it before when I was married. I just thought to myself the irony. I was married, and in the last 5 years of my marriage, we didn't have sex hardly at all. Like, no sex. And then to be like with someone that you have great sex with, and then it's like, no, you can't have sex for six weeks.
Like, I was just thinking about that. They put your shit on sexual probation, even though you can still grab it and sniff it and lick it, which I know you're doing. That's a no-brainer. You know, you can't move up and down. He can't come in your mouth real hard because you might jilt and a stitch will pop. But the whole fucking thing is that it's really weird when somebody tells you.
I'm sorry, Joey, but I just can't envision someone going down on me when the stitches are still viable.
No. You're sucking his dick. No. I don't want to see no stitches with pussy on it. No pussy with stitches. A pussy with a black eye right above it, like Frankenstein's fucking forehead. You know what I'm saying?
I don't want to see that. Your pussy look like it just got in a street
fight. I'm talking
about
you licking his fucking nuts. What are we talking about here, Bob? We're talking about you still doing your thing. So if you're bouncing and he comes in your neck real hard and your neck goes up, you might pop a stitch. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, it's totally.
Well, we even got to talk about this shit.
And no guy wants to hear, sorry, it shut down for 6 weeks.
No, that's when
my mouth is still available.
That's when you find out.
That's not sexy either.
That's when you find out what a man is really about. When you're on sexual probation for 6 weeks, how he acts.
Yeah.
That's when you find out if he's a soldier. Because I'll tell you what, and I think we talked about it on the podcast, and I've seen it on television, and we giggled. There is nothing sexier than a guy when a woman is sick. We want to fuck you. Like, when you got the flu or something, we get the horniest because we know we can't fuck you. You know what I'm saying?
Here you are
with your greasy hair and you're like, and we're dying to give you a fucking stabbing. You know what I'm saying? You smell like NyQuil and Vicks Vapor Rub and we're dying to tear up that fucking monkey. You follow me? So what I'm trying to say to you
you're
is...
You're like holding your breath and fucking at the same time so
really,
you don't get sick.
It's really weird that when people put a restriction on you, for some people it fucks with the head.
Right.
You know, it's really funny when I was in the halfway house, don't do blow. I was doing blow every fucking day just because somebody told me, don't do fucking blow. I didn't even need it. I didn't even care about it, but it's just that little mentality.
But there are some people when the doctor says you can't have sex for 6 weeks, they're like, phew, now I have an excuse.
Oh, please.
You
know, whatever.
They're usually the ones married to. If the doctor said that to them, they'd be like, fuck, you know?
No, that you know, think about it. If you married to somebody and you're with them for 20 years and you don't really want to have sex with that person or something. I mean, after 20 years, after 10 years, you've already done every position. You've hung her, you've stabbed her, you've done everything. But I'll tell you what. You want me to tell you what's kind of fucking crazy?
What?
And I really feel this. I don't know. But I think that when you love somebody at that point in the game, there's still that natural spark. It might not be every fucking day, but I still think it's kind of special because you love each other. That's just what I thought. That's just what I think. When I see people who are 80 and they're holding hands and they're going to bingo and shit, and you're like, wait a second, could they be fucking? But there was an article in Time magazine about 2 months ago about sex blowing up over the age of 50 now. Sex is at an all-time, sure, Viagra. But people are involved again. You know, people are staying healthy till they're 60. You know, there's a couple of women at my yoga class, I'll take you. I seen one 2 days ago. I went to go to hit the bag. And I see a lady from a different perspective. She's got to be 65 years old. She's in there fucking doing weights and stuff like that. And she doesn't look bad. She looks like Doris Day. I mean, I wouldn't fuck her. But you know she's in there in the gym trying to give up that ass. She's not doing leg curls because she's at home mending a fucking sweater.
You heard it here first.
Yeah, Papa's
Joey
probably...
Joey Diaz will not fuck Doris Day.
No, I wouldn't fuck Doris Day, but it's got to be weird when you get into your 60s. Do you still have sex? Is it still fun? If you've been with that person for 30 years, is there still a spark? That's pretty fucking sad to think somebody would have separate beds, even though it's a great idea. We fuck, see you later, bye. It's at that point in the relationship, 15 years, look, I love you and shit. You snore, my feet stink. Why do this to each other? You know what I'm saying? Why do this to each other?
I think that's when the problems start, when you do separate beds.
Nah, because sometimes it's better. At least you get a good night's fucking sleep.
Really?
When you wake up and you're rested, there's nothing better than that. Trust me, I got sleep apnea for those years. There's some times where some women just can't sleep with certain men. They fucking snore. You ever go to a hotel room and hear somebody snore from the room next door?
Yes, yeah.
What would you do if you were that guy's wife? What would you do? I love you.
You know what? I actually like when men snore, because then it's to me like they're really asleep, because then I can get up and go to the bathroom. You know what I mean? I hate when a man is one of those guys, every time you move, they're like, oh, what's going on? You know what I mean? Like you have to sneak out of the bed just to go pee or something, and they're like, where are you going? You know what I mean?
No, I don't move all night.
So when a man is out snoring and there's smoke coming out of his nose like a chimney, whatever, I don't care, as long as he sleeps heavy, because then I can relax, you know?
It's funny, my man Ari Shafir had a storyteller show yesterday. Uh-huh. He's been doing them for about a year now, and they've grown. He started at the lab. I give Ari a lot of credit. And they grew into the main room at the Improv, you know, uh-huh. And he charges $5. And he gets great comedians to go down there and tell stories, you know? And I didn't know how the show went last night. They had Bill Burr. Rogan was at it later on. And it's funny because it takes you to a different place in comedy. It takes you somewhere. And some people can't handle it. It's like working on your back. It's very tough storytelling because the jokes aren't there every 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. And us as comedians, we just can't handle it.
That's the hardest thing.
That's the hardest thing, to hear crickets and continue your story.
It's to trust yourself.
It's a confidence. It's a weird muscle to work, you know? And it was weird because I didn't tell. Ari called me this morning and I asked him how the show was right when we were outside before we came in. And I said, you know what? I'll tell you a story. And it's funny because I don't know if you ever watched The Godfather, the first Godfather. It's a very great movie, but people look at it and they go, oh, I like the part where Sonny got killed in the phone booth. Or the part that's always destroyed me, no matter how many times I watch it. Did I tell you about this?
I don't know.
Is when they're in the wedding, at the marriage and the wedding in the beginning.
I don't think he told me this part.
And he goes, he introduces her to Tom Hagen. And he introduces him as, this is my brother, Tom Hagen. And when he walks away, the Academy Award-winning actress looks at him. She's young. And she goes, how is he your brother? You know, you guys have a different last name. And he goes, well, when he was young, Sonny brought him home. And he's my brother. And I remember I was 10 when that movie came out. And I remember going home and waiting like a week and asking my mom, if I found somebody on the street, can I bring him home? Like a kid that didn't have a mommy or a daddy. And she was like, yeah. You know, but what are you talking about? I'm like, it's weird. I went to see The Godfather, and there's a lot of kids out there that don't have moms and dads. If I find one, can I bring one home? We got the attic, and we got the downstairs. And she's like, sure, you know, bring somebody home. But she, you know, and I went looking. For years, I was like, man, I need to find an orphan. You know what I'm saying? I got to get me an orphan. That's cool. I'm an only child. Right. I have a brother. He really wasn't my brother, you know? Uh-huh. What a great fucking relationship, you know? I never fucking thought about it. And it was just cool. The whole thing just seemed cool to me, that a family would adopt a kid. Oh, my God, really? People do that? You could do that in this day and age? It just touched my heart. It was like, unless my mother died. You know, and I had my uncle to live with in California. I had my godfather in Miami, which were nice people. I didn't want to, definitely my godfather was out. And I had my stepfather in Union City, New Jersey. But I couldn't live with that fucking tyrant at that age. I was already set in my ways. I had no curfew. I had nothing. And it was funny that I had gotten into a fight when I was a kid with this guy that stuck up for somebody else. We had a beef and he got into it. And me and him got into a fight. And he pretty fucked me up. He hit my eye and he broke my nose and he broke my lip. I got a couple of shots at him. But I could tell he felt bad about the fight. I had never known him really before the fight. What's that?
Is this your stepfather that did this?
No. Just some kids. Just we got into a fight.
I'm sorry.
And we weren't enemies. It was just a misunderstanding. But we got into a brawl. We were in the sixth grade. Mm-hmm. And about a year later, we became, you know, he apologized. He's like, dog, what was I thinking? And his mother used to cook, and she fucking hated me. His mother just hated Spex. That's it. That's just how life is. She was Sicilian. It was the 70s. They didn't really like Spanish kids. You know, they thought that Spanish kids were burglars or whatever, you know. And he would bring me over. And she would say, what the fuck? And she would make little remarks at me, like, good country, America. You know, good country, huh, Jose? You know, good. Like, she wouldn't try to embarrass me. But I would sit there, like, going, you're trying to embarrass me, but I'm eating your food. Who's embarrassed? You know what I'm saying? And he would pour the meatballs on and stuff. And then we got to the point where I would trade him my motorcycle for Wednesday dinner. He would borrow my motorcycle once a week if I go to his house and eat Wednesday dinner, all you could eat. And he would tell me, you know, you're eating my mother's meatballs. She rolls them with her feet. Remember I told you about this shit? And all of a sudden, we were just friends. And I would go swimming in his pool. And his father liked me all the time. And all the kids would always leave, and he was the first one to have a below-the-ground pool. And I would always skim it at the end because I had a pool and I know what it was. People come over, they swim, then they all leave when it's time to clean the fucking pool. There's leaves, you're pissing in my fucking pool. And I would just stick around. That's how I was raised. Before you leave, pick up the towels. You want to come over again.
Right.
You want the people. That's how my mother raised me. Listen, when you go to people's houses, pick up your fucking mess, all right? You want people to have you over again, all right? Don't embarrass me. Get the fuck out of here.
Right.
So one day, I'm leaving at about 6. We were there all day eating the people's food. And the mother was hating me. And he comes out and he's like, you want to go to the track? You know? And he took me to the track. And then we had this little relationship that I would meet him on the corner. I would call and say, you going to the track, Mr. B? And I just started going to the track with the guy. You know? Just to the track. He was an older guy. He had 3 sons. All of them were dunces, you know, including my buddy at the time. And he just liked me. And he taught me how to sell the tickets. And, you know, when people won their tickets, how to trade them in and get 10% of the winnings. And it was just great, you know. But I had, like, I was one of these kids that I hung out in a lot of families' houses. So, boom, here my mother dies. I'm sitting there, like, the last fucking night. And all these draft picks. I was like a draft pick. I had the Garcias were the first bidders. They came over to me. They were a Cuban family. I had 2 girls, and he wanted a boy. And I got along with the girls. I was always over there. They're the ones that used to forge my my report cards.
Oh, really?
They were forgers. They were badass Cuban bitches that were hot. They were both over 6 feet. So they came to me first, and they're like, listen, man, we don't have that much room, but we'd rather you stay in a Cuban house and keep up your traditions and your family. Come live with us. We have a company, a paperclip and pen company. You could stay with us and get a job. And I was like, "That's." But I had an air conditioner. I had cable TV in my room. I had my own bedroom. I had carpeting. I was holding out for the highest bidder. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I was like, hold on. They're going to come out of the woodwork. Then the Balzanos raised their hand right away. They were like, Doug, you could just move into Anthony's room because he had died, the kid I hung out with.
Right.
You could just move into his room. Your family here anyway. Just move in. And some of the Avillos, this other football family raised their hand. They're like, you can move with us. But they were really cool, and I really like Steve. I really like Steve. So I'm like, hold on. So I waited all the offers. And the last night, right before they're going to bury my mother, Jimmy Bender came, which was the father. He came to my mother's funeral with all these fucking spics playing conga drums. He showed up. He was from Lithuania. He was white. He didn't know nothing about this. And he walked up to the casket. And he goes, it would break my heart if you went anywhere else. And I was like, are you serious? Because I knew he didn't care about hours. You know, he didn't care about when you walked in and out. They ate at all hours. And he goes, you're just going to have to win Anna over. But you could move in, your family. It would break my heart if you went somewhere else. You've been over my house. Plus, I want to care for you. You're a good guy. And it was weird that life, you know, a movie, something that I thought about at an early age. And it was so weird now to think about, like, so many hints I had as a young man that my mother was going to pass. Like, when I was in the 8th grade, I dated a girl, Colleen Maines, and she was this hot little Irish girl, and she would always tell me, you'd come to my house after school. And I would go over there, and one day I said, don't you have a mom? Where's your fucking mom at? And she's like, my mom died at childbirth. And I remember that it just hit me a certain way. Like, it was like, fuck. And I remember leaving there thinking, what does a kid do when they lose their mother? How do they survive, you know? And it was just so many signals that I had reacted to, and all of a sudden life... a thought became my life and all these people. So it's really weird that some, you know, the show is about family. Sometimes your family could be your friends and you don't even fucking know it, you know, you really don't even know it. And it's weird when you have that bond, because like I've said before, you know, it's a shame that my parents died when I was young, but God showed me a different window. He showed me that people on the street sometimes are more of a family in your own blood, and you don't know that until you live it. And I seen it. So I worked on a show last night. It's so hilarious because the law has always intrigued me. I told Felicia that when this company hired me for this TV show, they said, you know what? Since it's a pizza place, we might bring the pizza place back. And then they were actually looking at 2 dates. They even said to me, block out the week of July 12th and something else. But then yesterday, as I'm doing my paperwork, because it was my first day, they made me do a background check. And as I'm filling out the background check, I'm like, take a look around. You ain't going to see this place ever again. You know what I'm saying?
Are you nervous?
No, because I haven't done nothing. It's not like, you know, but it was like, I can't believe that in this day and age, they're still fucking doing background. And they should. For all good, they should. I don't want somebody talking to my kid that doesn't have a background check. But it's funny because I have no, like, you know, I've never sexually molested nobody. I have no felonies like that. But what are they going to do when they see kidnapping? Are they going to just sit around a table and look at each other and go, so he's not a fucking perv, but.
Yeah.
Whew.
So are you nervous about that?
No. Yeah. What am I going to do? It was 1987. Yeah. If you don't understand, like I told you outside, you don't understand that I've turned my life around and I don't want to be around you anyway.
That's right.
You know, there's people who do make mistakes and don't turn their life around.
Yeah.
Or at least give it an effort or get in trouble again. And hey, I'm here to tell you, I got in trouble a bunch of times after I came out of prison. Now, you think I learned my lesson? I was still out there causing mayhem in a lower level.
Yeah.
I knew that if I got caught, I could do 2 years or a year. But it's so weird to even think that way. You know what I'm saying? So it wasn't like I just became fucking Johnny Saints. Like I said, I still shoplift lighters a year ago. I still haven't changed, but I know how bad a karma. I always knew how bad a karma. But karma was standing. You don't think of karma when you're doing crimes. You just write them off. It's so weird that if somebody can't understand that I really changed my route, you know, like the route has really changed, then we shouldn't even do business.
Exactly.
So that's how I feel, you sexy motherfucker. How's your recuperation doing?
My recuperation's going good. I'm getting a lot of stuff done, and I started back up on our secret project.
Now, what is your, how much longer is your recovery time as far
as
you?
I'm good.
You're good. You don't have to go to no therapist. You don't got to know no x-rays, no jumping jacks in front of a tube. You don't got to drink milk in front of a fucking camera and they look at all your ribs. Nothing like that.
Yeah, it's all good. Yeah.
You're good.
Yeah.
Congratulations. No rehab, nothing.
Yeah, and I'm excited. I work tomorrow night for the first time, and then in 2 weeks I'm off again traveling to Edmonton to do some comedy there the week of July 6th through the 10th.
Where are you tomorrow night, you sexy animal?
I'm going to be at the John Lovitz.
Okay,
yes. Beautiful. Frank called me. Yeah, I was very happy about that.
It's so weird how for you people who live outside of California or in the LA area, they're closing the 405 both directions from July 16th to the 18th.
Yes, they're calling it Carmageddon.
Carmageddon. And you know what, guys? It wouldn't be that bad if this was like a city where there was regular people. But these motherfuckers, you know, I don't know if anybody's ever been to Seattle. Beautiful place. But let's be honest with each other. There should never be traffic in that place. It's the people who make the traffic in Seattle. And when you're in Seattle, you're like, why is there traffic? Because these fucking momos want it to be traffic.
Yeah.
You follow me? What's going to happen here is they're telling you that weekend not to leave the fucking house. This is like you, no sex for the fucking weekend. You know what I'm saying? So you have to make around that. I am making no plans for that weekend because I don't like getting caught in cars when the 405 is open.
So you're going to stock up and ride it out?
Stock up, get a skateboard, get a little hat with a propeller on it, whatever the fuck I need. I got a gig that Thursday night, and when I park that car Friday, that car ain't
Where's
moving.
Your gig Thursday night?
Thursday night I have a gig downtown or something, just some Cisco gig, Lakewood or something like that. But it's like that Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I'm in. No, there's no reason.
Yeah,
I feel bad for people if you got wedding plans. I feel bad for people who made plans that weekend for parties and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But you know what, man? It's just not worth the aggravation both ways. It really is.
Well, the activity partner lives right where they're doing
so
it. He's fucked.
He's in for the weekend.
Yeah, he's in for the weekend.
Get the guitar and the ukulele and start writing songs, bitch. You know what I'm saying? Get the fucking writing, cocksucker.
We're all going to... There'll be a lot of crafts going on that weekend,
that's it,
for sure.
Yeah, where are you going to go?
Yeah.
It's all going to carry over. I mean, you know, a couple weeks ago, again, I was on the 405 at 1 in the afternoon on a Saturday. And it was the end of May, and it was warm out. And you could already see the people going to Disneyland, San Diego. They want to go to the beach. With all these people, they still have plans. And there's some people going to get up and say, fuck it. I'm going down there anyway. And they're going to get caught in this fucking magnitude. That's going to be whacknitude. How many times have you been on the 405 and there's traffic on the 5? You merge onto the 5.
Oh, yeah.
And it's bumper to bumper.
Great,
And it's weird how people are going to react. Me, I'm taking the shortest route possible. You don't need to go nowhere.
Yeah.
There's nothing you're
going to go to Yum Yums.
Yum Yums, routes, and watch there'll be like a fucking earthquake that weekend. Or,
oh, that would be terrible.
Or a tornado or something, just to really make it worse. But I'll tell you what's crazy. When I was sitting there watching the news this morning, they were talking about, if I was still a criminal, I'd be planning a big heist.
Really?
Sure.
What heist?
Sure, a bank.
Really?
Oh my God, on the other side of town, away from traffic, away from a police station, away from the road, something that you could just escape.
Yeah, but it's a weekend.
You're right, see, you're right.
You know when to do it would be Monday morning.
Monday morning, 9:01. As soon as they open up that fucking vault, you go in there with 19 motherfuckers and just freeze!
You're right. Or Friday afternoon.
Nah, because they're not closing it till Saturday at 5 a.m.
Oh, I thought they were closing it.
No, they're closing it Friday night at 4 a.m. So you have the whole day Friday, which people are going to still be bad.
Oh, that's
because they're
going
to be hustling to get their shit. So I'm going before the traffic starts. So you're probably right. Friday at fucking 3:30, going to Bank of America with 22 machine guns and 10 Puerto Ricans. Just say what the.
Oh my God! Let's hope that doesn't happen,
what
Joey.
What the fuck is really crack-a-lackin' in this motherfucker?
No, no, no.
Come up with. I had a friend when I lived in Colorado. When I went to, you know, it's very funny. When I lived in New York, I lived around all these knuckleheads. Yeah, I'll fuck them up, and they had guns and stuff like that. And you meet people, but when I went to Colorado, I met the patois of life. And the more you go up in the hills, the more interesting it gets. And I had this, I had at my fondest Charles Bronson moment when I was planning on coming back here and killing my stepfather for taking my mother's money and for killing her, for doing all that shit to my stepmother, like he broke her heart. I had a plan that I was going to come back here, hide under a car and shoot him.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't know how I was going to execute everything. I didn't know how I was going to get a gun, how I was going to do nothing. And I'm living in Basalt, Colorado, which is a suburb of Aspen,
mm-hmm.
on the way down the 82, which is one of the worst roads ever in the country. It's a two-laner, and once they get 6 inches of snow, motherfucker, you better have chains and you better know how to drive, because you will end up in Woody Creek on top of Don motherfucking Johnson's roof. You follow me? So this lady used to come over because the guys used to have like an office job at a bank,
mm-hmm.
and the girls from the bank and some of the employees would come over and smoke pot. And one of their wives used to say, my husband's going to love you. She'd always say, he's going to love you. And one day she started bringing me over there, and the guy was very quiet. He smoked cigars. He was big in stature, 6'1", and he was a hunter. And we would talk, and after 2 or 3 weeks, she started watching movies, and he would say, sleep over on Fridays, and Saturday we'll go shooting. And we would shoot, and his shooting was fucking impeccable, Felicia. Impeccable. This motherfucker could shoot a gun, a rifle, a bow. He was just impeccable. So the more weeks we started talking, one day he took out his dog tags. And he was like, I was elite for 8 years. This is what I did. I retired after 10. Da-da-da-da-da-da. He got shot in the leg. He showed me his scars and shit. They cut his fucking foot. He had a replacement fucking ankle. I mean, it was just crazy. He showed me all these pictures. And then he pulled his couch up. And this motherfucker had the shit Rambo has that you pull and it shoots out launches.
Right.
He had everything.
Holy shit, I had hit
Eureka. So after that, there was no more family movies. Me, him, and Joy, that was her name, would watch a family movie. Then Joy would go to sleep, and me and him would watch a Charles Bronson movie. And we'd sit there and look at each other. This is how I would kill him. I'd slice his throat, and he'd say, no, 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 no. This is how you got to kill him. And he just was a genius. And one time, somebody fucked with his wife, and he called me up, and he taught me how to wire the guy's house with the booby trap, with the grenade and everything. So when he stepped on the line, the thing would blow up. I mean, this guy was crazy. His wife talked him out of it. He let the gas in the guy's trailer, Charles Bronson style. But his big claim to fame, his big dream, was to rob Aspen Bank on Christmas Eve. He said they would never, either Christmas Eve or New Year's Day or the day after New Year's. He says the banks are packed with money from all the New Year's stuff, and they'll never catch us. All the cops are on the mountain. He wanted to rob the bank of Aspen and ski-mobiles. Let me tell you something. For 60 days, I mind-fucked myself like I never mind-fucked myself. I was swimming. I thought I was James Bond. I was running in the mountains. I learned how to camp. I learned how to rub two twigs together. I was ready to go. I was getting on this heist. You saw about $4 million. We go in there. We'll chop it up. We need 8 guys. And he's like, dog, I need some shooters. So if you know anybody, I'm like, I don't know nobody. I really didn't. I know people who were crazy. I didn't know people who were elite like this guy. This guy just knew how to fucking ice people. But then it was just a mind fuck. He went and had kids, and the dream went away. You know what I'm saying? The dream.
By the way, that would be a great game, video game at fantasyheist.com.
And it was weird that, you know, he always said it. You know, the diversion is the New Year's. People are not going to expect it. He goes, people don't expect bad things to happen. They won't even react to it.
So were you guys going to do it?
Oh, my God. We went up there. We set it up. But then he got a big-time job working for the Aspen Bus Company. He's still there 20 years later. And he's like, well, I robbed a joint. I'm not doing so bad after all. You know what I'm saying? But he was, he taught me how to shoot. He gave me a couple guns. This guy was just amazing. But one of the things he taught me was, this is 1983. He kept saying, if you're ever going to hate somebody, he used to say it. He goes, these fucking people kill people. That's how they get caught. He goes, you got two people right in front of people. Go up to a circle of people and blast somebody. Watch, they'll never be a witness. I mean, this guy just had, and you'd sit there and go, this guy is fucking crazy. crazy. He was white. I don't have to tell you, Felicia. Yeah. You know these guys in Colorado. He was kind of a country western guy.
No, there's some, yeah.
But he really wasn't. People
who live up and alone.
Yeah.
Like, my dad used to live in 29 Palms, and it's like, what's up?
I love
those
guys.
Trailer park in the desert?
Yeah,
what's up?
You know, these guys are just, and it's amazing, but in Colorado, they're not like fucking the mountain guy that sent powder and tried to blow up something. They're killers, but they're controlled. And they're quiet. They teach you how to do all these. Like, he taught me how to go camp, and he had no kids, you know, at that time. Now they got like 3 fucking gorillas for boys. But it was so weird that I got to meet somebody. But just the thought that he kept telling me about icing somebody, and I always kept on the back of my mind. And then what happened in 1985? One of the greatest not mass murders, one of the greatest street killings of all time. John Gotti killed Paul Castellano. When did he do it? A week before Christmas. Where? In the heart of New York City at 5:30 in the afternoon. Did they ever convict him of it? Yeah, after Sammy the Bull rolled. There was 5 fucking shooters, and nobody fucking seen one. Felicia's looking at me like, Joey, are you fucking crazy? But what I'm just making a point that what he said was right. He goes, don't ice somebody in the dark or whatever. Ice them in a circle in front of a bunch of people. So I'm giving Felicia ideas. She might be flying up to Montreal.
Oh, my God.
With a fucking knife and shit like that.
Wow, yeah. Well, I mean, you know.
Have you ever been to Spark Steakhouse? Yeah. If you're ever in New York, go to Spark Steakhouse. Stop. Cross the street at Sparks. Whether it's 3 in the afternoon or 10 o'clock at night, cross the street, sit there and go to yourself. John Gotti got 4 guys to kill a guy on this street at this restaurant right now. Are you fucking kidding me or what? That was something that when I didn't even know it. I don't care. You kill somebody on the street or whatever. I was doing the New York Comedy Club one night. Before you go on stage, you get nervous and go for a walk.
Uh-huh.
I went for a walk, and that's how I realized. I went for a walk, and all of a sudden I'm like, that's Spark Steakhouse on 3rd Avenue, wherever the fuck it was. It was right around the corner from the New York Comedy Club at the time, Al Martin. And I'm like, look at this fucking place. He killed somebody in front of here. Even at night, there's people in front of here. I can't even imagine at 5:30. That takes balls.
Yeah.
So if you're going to kill somebody, kill him in a public place around a lot of people and put on a fur with a fucking Russian hat. I don't know. That's
how here's an idea. Just try not to kill someone.
Yeah, just
try
not to kill
somebody.
Why are we talking about this, Felicia? Why are you getting involved in this Colorado shit? What's up, you sexy thing?
Well, I hate to drone on about the operation, but I was just thinking, I feel so good. Like, I was dreading the operation, and I am so glad it's over, and I'm so lucky because I have another friend who's going through something way more serious than what I had, way more serious, and I'm just feeling great. You know, like, when you get sick like that, like, it takes you over, you know, and you kind of forget a part of yourself. It's
it
like
had
you
bothered
lose
you for a couple months.
Yeah, and my memory was bad.
Yeah, I
Everything
could tell
was
something was bothering you. And, you know, remember 20 years ago, Felicia, you were a lot younger, and one day you were broke. We all come to a time when we're young, when we're broke, and we feel like that's the
end of
the world.
I was so broke, dude. Don't make me tell you what I did to pay my rent.
You ever say to somebody, hey, man, I'm fucking broke. And they'll go, psh, I'm broke too, but at least we got our health. And you left there going, the fuck are you talking about my health? There you go.
Yeah.
And this is what people mean with that expression. Because no money, no comedy, no success is possible without your fucking health.
Yeah.
And it's really weird. Like, even when I go to get blood tests for that weekend, my mind's in fuck. Because I'm thinking of this blood test. What are they going to find? What ain't they going to find?
Yeah.
You know, your health, it's very fucking important. That's why people say that all the time, you know. And we take it for granted that we could walk. We take so many things for granted that we could see out of both eyes. That every time we don't eat a candy bar, we wake up with fucking passed out with a dick in your ass from fucking, you know. I mean, you're so grateful.
I miss those days.
And, yeah, no, and it's so weird that this is what it's about, Felicia.
Right, right.
If you don't have your health, you can't do dick. You can't do dick.
It's
and
true.
Listen, don't get me wrong. I know somebody right now that broke their ankle, and she called me and she goes, I don't know what to do. You know, and I said, well, we always wanted to write a book.
Yeah.
You can't walk. You always wanted to write a book. You know, if you watch Dragon, the Bruce Lee story, they fucking broke his neck. And his wife came in and she said, if you want to give up, bitch, give up. You're the one that's always talking all this shit about this and water and technique. Talk and I'll write. Let's write a book. And it's called The Tao of Jeet Kune Do. He wrote it when he was in the hospital with a fucking neck brace on.
Oh, really?
Yeah, The Tao of Jeet Kune Do is one of the most popular books. And you read it, and it's all what was in his head. All those little things, years of little things that he wanted to tell people that he could never tell people. So when you're in that position, you know, your health, whatever, there's other ways. Like, don't let it beat you the fuck down. It doesn't mean that you stop.
Yeah.
You kept doing stand-up, and that's the number one thing. That I have friends that are a little sick, but they won't release it to nobody because they feel that it's that people are going to look upon them. They're entertainers.
Yeah.
But you got to keep going. You got to keep going. You got to keep writing. And that's what will make everything okay until everything goes away, I guess.
Absolutely.
And look how good you look.
Thank you.
I know you've been focusing on your diet because I will fucking torture you until you get ass back.
I've been eating like I have no ass right now. And I've been eating like a hog. I've been pounding Ben and Jerry's pistachio. Let me give a shout out to pistachio.
Damn, let's give a shout out to Ben and motherfucking Jerry.
Jerry's, yeah.
Because those motherfuckers, I don't know what they were thinking up there in Vermont. They were in there freezing one day and they're like, what the fuck are we going to do today?
Yep.
We got weed. We got cable. There's nowhere we could go, and we got nothing to eat. What are we going to do? Well, I got some fucking fudge, and I got some milk. Let's make New York Super Fudge Chunk. Have you ever had New York Super Fudge Chunk? Between New York Super Fudge Chunk and...
No, I'm not a big fudgy person, but my kids love it.
Oh, New York Super Fudge Chunk and the fucking sleep apnea and the blow is what put the 150 pounds on my frame.
Yeah,
that was the contributor. Yeah. I was eating a whole pint of it with a whole thing of Coca-Cola, just putting in a glass.
Oh, really?
But the best thing about New York Super Fudge Chunk is at the end, all the shit from it goes to the bottom, and it gets a little softer. So you're drinking chocolate with Coke and little cherries.
I'm going to make that for my kids. Oh, I just had a flash of root beer and pistachio.
Yeah, delicious. Oh, we don't appreciate the American float as much as we should.
Yeah.
It's a motherfucker, or even an egg cream. It's a motherfucker on your waistline, but it really makes things go by a little easier for the next few hours. You know what I'm saying?
If you guys can see Joey's face, he's so happy right now.
If you don't have no reefer and the world is upon you, let me tell you something. You look in that refrigerator, there's a little ice cream and a little fudge. You know what? You might not have all your things in your world, but bitch, you got ice cream and fudge with a little bit of whipped cream. And that's
better start to banging, right?
Better start to banging. It's funny because I got a few emails. I was gone. I went to Pittsburgh for a few days. And I want to talk about Pittsburgh real quick. I want to give a shout out to the people of Pittsburgh because I've been to Buffalo. I've been to Cleveland. I've been to all those cities on the verge. And those are the great American law cities. You know, Fisher-Price pulled out of here. American Auto pulled out of here. And these cities have been left with nothing. And if you go to Detroit, they have nothing.
Last Detroit's year was
one of
in
my
Detroit,
favorites.
Yeah.
Oh, they have nothing. If you go to Cleveland, they're shutting down half the fucking town. If you go to Buffalo, God bless you motherfuckers. You know, it's shut down up there too, half the town. Fisher Price, you know, Buffalo has the number one attendance in minor league baseball. We've discussed this. But let me tell you something. I went up to Pittsburgh, and you guys are as proud as they come as Americans. I didn't go to the game on Sunday. Pittsburgh was playing the Boston Red Sox, and they were there all weekend. I was doing a show, and I went to see the UFC, but it's so weird. I walked to the stadium just to touch Roberto Clemente's statue, and I brought a fucking camera with me, and I could not find where the camera was, and then when I got back last night, I opened up the sleep apnea case, and there was the fucking camera.
Who packed it there?
Me! And I forgot I was stoned when I packed. It was late night. Yeah. Things happen, but it's so weird how we did a show at some Carnegie Mellon Theater. And this theater, Felicia,
I hate
talking about stand-up on here. You know, the first one will say, dog, save it for later.
Yeah.
This theater, Felicia, when the day comes that we're shooting a real DVD for HBO or Showtime or, God forbid, ABC, whoever, I'm picking that theater. I don't care.
Really?
It is the low ceilings, 1,000 seats.
Oh, wow.
Perfect. You feel like you're in somebody's living room extended.
Really?
Really, really nice. And after the show, let me tell you something, nobody wanted to leave. We hung out in the parking lot. It was the biggest high school party in the world. And we just talked
and
bullshitted.
That's so fun when that
happens.
So
many people were like, where's Felicia? Beauty and the Beast. I mean, it was a fucking world of people. And I just want to give the city of Pittsburgh, I just shit my last pimenti sandwich that I had. Pimenti Brothers sandwich.
Pimenti Brothers sandwich. Oh, yeah.
I just shit the last pastrami out this morning. I had to light a candle in the fucking bathroom. The cats even ran away.
Thank you for doing that before you came to my house.
Yeah, but I really, really want to give Pittsburgh a shout out because you're a great city who kept going and it really inspired me. Beautiful. Clean. I mean, it was just, and I had been to Pittsburgh years before. I worked the Funny Bone, but they're out of business now. But it was just, it really blew my mind. I got an email this morning, and I got one yesterday, and they both said the same thing. They said that one guy apologized, a kid, young kid, and he emailed me with a certain problem he had, but he also said that I'm 16, and I heard through the grapevine that you don't like kids listening to the podcast. So I answered him back, and then there was another guy who Facebooked me who said I'm 14, and you might not think I'm old enough, but I understand what you're saying. Thank you. And he spelt some of the words wrong, so I could tell he was 14.
Right.
You know
By
saying?
The way, that might be our genius
That's
PR
our
move.
That's our genius PR move. But it's so weird how I never, I don't know if we had this discussion. Yeah, we did, because obviously somebody, it's not that I mind kids listening, is that if you listen to this, I want you to know what to do with it. I don't want you to go out and buy an 8-ball because Uncle Joey said that it was fun when he was 15. That's not what I'm fucking saying. And that's not what Felicia's saying. Felicia
no,
has children,
yeah.
And she wouldn't approve of it. Hey, you know what? If you're 13 and you're listening, I got to love you deep down inside. I really got to love you because that was me. I listened to Pryor when I was 12. I put the Beatle album over Pryor, you know, Help. You know what I'm saying? So if mom came, the fucking, I was allowed to curse in my house, but I wasn't allowed to listen to something like that. My mom would have came in and said, what?
I have the opposite rule in my house.
No, it was...
My kids can listen to anything.
Okay, yeah, no, no.
Except Beauty and the Beast.
Okay.
But they can't curse.
Have they ever heard Pryor? Have you ever put...
No, you know, but they're really into comedy, obviously, because of what I do, and their father's also in the business in some aspect. And but they're really... So they were doing SNL lines when they were 2 or 3 years old.
Okay,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. But so you were allowed to cuss, but you weren't allowed to listen to anything?
No, it was kind of weird. I just felt embarrassed. But it was so weird that when you listened to that as a kid, and even when you went out with your friends or you smoked a half a joint or whatever you did, you had this little power over you, even at 13 or 12. You know what I'm saying? You had that little piece of... I'm a man, or I'm a
really?
Woman. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, because you're a kid and you're listening to adult humor.
Right. Okay.
It says adult humor, and here you are, 11, giggling, and hee. You know, when one of the kids says, "Did you ever get a blowjob?" And you're like, hee, knowing that you're fucking lying. You know, that's the thing of being a kid. So if you listen to the podcast, it's not that I don't like you listening to the podcast. I don't want you going out and mugging a hooker or looking for your own Sticky Charlie. These are things that happened to me, and this was the 70s. It was completely different.
It was different then.
What I want you to take is the main message from this, that we fucked up, life goes on, and you can pick up the pieces. That's the main message of this. And you're 14, you're 12, you're 16, guess what? I don't care how much money your parents have, how smart you are, what they don't have, you're going to have obstacles in your life. You're just going to have them. You know, everything, you're going to have obstacles. And I hope that this show just... helps you push through those obstacles. That's it. I don't want you to listen and go, well, fucking Joey, Felicia stripped, so maybe I should become a stripper. No. There was different situations. If that's a path you fucking lead, do it with pride, like Felicia did it. Do it with pride. Be a fucking stripper and go on there and shake that fucking pussy. Whatever you're going to do, be the best that you could do. But do not, we don't want you to do something crazy just because we talk about it on the show.
Absolutely.
Whether it's tripping or smoking dope, live your life. You're a kid. Enjoy being a kid. When you're 21, email me and ask me, Joey, should I smoke dope now? And I'll tell you, drink a glass of milk and get back to me after you drink the glass of milk. Once the glass of chocolate milk don't taste good for you, it's time to smoke a joint. And guess what, motherfucker?
Oh my God.
And guess what, motherfuckers? No, Felicia, because
oh
I'm 48
God.
Years old and chocolate milk still tastes good.
Oh, okay.
Do you understand me?
Okay,
understand?
Okay.
When chocolate milk don't taste good for you anymore, then you have my permission to smoke a joint. And guess what? I'm 48 and chocolate milk is still yummy, 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 bitch.
Yeah, because you smoked the joint and it...
Shut up, Felicia! That's why I didn't want them to fucking know you fuck. I didn't want them to know I got the monkeys and I drank chocolate milk. It's not about that. That's why some kid emailed me a day in his Twitter with glasses. You know, he told Uncle Joey, can you tell me, am I ready to get high yet? And I wrote him a thing that said, listen, dog, drink a chocolate milk and get back to me and eat a cookie or something. He got back to me 3 days later. He goes, I drank the chocolate milk and I ate the cookie. Now what? And it's like, I'm just trying to explain that life is okay without the reefer. At some point, if you want to smoke it to really expand your mind, I really want you to think before you do anything. That's all we're trying to say. Before you, you know, I smoke pot.
Because here's the thing. It's not for everybody. Like,
it's
how
not
many,
for everybody.
How many people do you know? I know. I have a lot of friends who are, if they smoke it, it makes them paranoid. They have flop sweats. It's not for them.
I have best friends that do not get high, and I have no problem with that at all. I appreciate their honesty.
Because you know, when someone can't do it, they can't do it.
They can't do it.
And you don't want to be around them.
I have friends that are nerds that I love that they don't smoke pot. I have friends that are totally against it in Jersey. Yeah. They don't even like me in the car with that fucking smell of weed, and I don't bring it around them because that's what they like, and I respect that. So if you don't get high or you don't do the dumb shit that people do, I'm still going to fucking love you. I respect you even more. But some people smoke pot and realize it's not for them. Some
it's
people do coke. I don't like alcohol.
I don't like
I've
beer.
Never drank alcohol.
I don't
get the fucking alcohol thing.
I don't get beer.
But that's not for me, and I don't condemn it.
Today, the Pope is going to do his first tweet. Yeah.
Listen, times are changing. Fidel Castro's on fucking Twitter.
Is he tweeting?
Yeah, he's on Twitter. He tweets in Spanish. You know, he tweets. you know, socialism, yeah, fucking sentences, you know, al esfuerzo de lo mismo de una revolución.
What does that mean?
No los queremos, no los necesitamos.
What does that mean?
That means in the fucking fate of a revolution, we don't need the weak.
Yeah.
We don't need them, and guess what, bitch? We don't want them.
Yeah, I thought it would be something like, Beyonce is on a different level than others. I'm just saying. That's what I want Castro to tweet.
It was funny because I seen a funny thing today on Yahoo. It said, Jennifer Aniston gives out relationship advice to women. And I wrote, yeah, if you don't suck cock, keep your husband away from other professional cocksuckers. You know what I'm saying? That's the truth.
You really wrote that?
Yeah, if you don't suck cock, don't let your husband go around professional cocksuckers. Yeah, yeah. If you don't like sucking cock because the smell and the taste, you're not going to let your husband hang out with Angelina Jolie. That chick will suck the blood out of your fucking dick.
You know what? My call on that whole thing is Jennifer Aniston probably bitched at Brad Pitt in the morning that he was having a scene with Angelina Jolie to take the fucking trash out, and he was like, fuck this.
Well, I'm going to tell you, one of my favorite fucking movies of all time is The Devil's Own, and it's with Brad Pitt and my man Harrison Ford. It's about the Irish, and Treat Williams is in it. It's not an Academy Award winner, but let me tell you what was going on with Brad Pitt in New York at the time. He was dating Jennifer Aniston, and he was in New York, and the cops had to come to his trailer like 10 fucking times while he was shooting that, because he was blasting Super Unknown and he was blasting Bad Motor Finger by Soundgarden. But the beauty of it was him and Harrison Ford were in there smoking dope like three fucking pirates. They smoked dope. Harrison Ford smokes more fucking dope than me, anybody. Him and Calista Flockhart. They used to see him at Cushmart years ago. Not at Cushmart, at the one on Sunset. Look, there's a weed store on Santa Monica that used to close at 7:30. And people used to say, why 7:30? Because from 7:38, it was for people who didn't want to be seen. But the main people was Harrison Ford and Calista Flockhart. Uh-huh. They're deep, deep, deep into reefer. So part of the thing I heard
is this
was
a well-known fact? Or
this
you
is a well-known fact. Oh, this is a well-known fact. I wouldn't fucking bullshit here.
I didn't know that.
Because you're not hanging out in Santa Monica with the boys. So, and what was going on was one of my friends that lived next to Ralphie was a wardrobe guy. And he worked on the movie in New York. And he goes, oh, my God. She would pitch at him because she didn't like him smoking pot. She's from Friends, and she's from that, you know, oh my God, NBC. And here's Brad Pitt smoking like a motherfucker, reeking of it, you know what I'm saying, in his clothes.
Yeah.
So that was the thing. You could tell it. I mean, Jennifer Aniston's a beautiful girl, but don't take you a genius to know.
Yeah,
no, you could tell that she...
She's one of those people that shouldn't smoke pot.
No, but you could tell that she's very... You know, when she was on Friends, they were probably snooty, and he comes around listening to the fucking Bad Motor Finger smoking dope, and she's like, what the fuck are you doing? He couldn't take it no more. And like I said, if you're going to suck dick with a napkin in your hand, don't let your husband go around professional cocksuckers. Just don't. That's relationship advice.
Napkin in your hand, yeah.
That's relationship advice 101. If you're a lady and you don't feed your cat, don't let him go to the fucking to the pound and hang out with 30 other cats. You know what I'm saying? Especially a blowjob from fucking, because I'm no genius. Let me tell you something. The best thing about, I've had guys come up to me and go, look at that woman there. She looks like she could give a mean blowjob. Once a guy has that thought in his head, you're fucking curtains. Once a guy goes out of the house thinking, I haven't got my dick sucked because she doesn't like sucking dick, because she doesn't like the gag reflex and how it tastes, whatever. You know what? You go out, and once you're around a professional cocksucker, somebody who loves sucking a dick, you're a goner. Because if you're a handsome guy like Brad Pitt, a professional cocksucker could just look at you and hypnotize you. They could send you subliminal suggestions, licking your balls, drinking your sperm, come in my eyeball. They could just send them to you. And that's what Angelina Jolie did. That motherfucker never even came home. He wrote a letter like fucking Marlon Brando in fucking Apocalypse Now. Sell the car, sell the kids, fuck you, fuck the dog. I mean, you know, that's what you do when you run into a professional cocksucker and she swallows your dick like a fucking sword. What are you going to do? You're going to come back and hang out with friends and another little fucking fag to hang out with. What's the girl? Oh my God, so get the fuck out of here. I'm over here with Angelina Jolie. They're sucking my dick, and at the same time, I got an IV in my fucking arm. You understand me? When a woman sucks your dick and you need an IV in your arm, that's a dick sucking. You're going to go back to your little shack in Santa Monica? Fuck you. Felicia knows. She's a professional dick sucker.
You
Felicia
are
knows.
Preaching
if
to
you
the
come
choir.
Around Felicia and you haven't gotten a blowjob in a year and she senses it, you're done. You ever watch those Discovery Channel animal fucking things? You're done. Done. And Felicia's a professional. She'll suck your dick out of just principal fucking things. If you tell Felicia you haven't gotten a dick suck in a year, she'll look at you like a mommy. Really? Oh, I'll suck your dick for you. What the fuck? It's Tuesday in Hollywood, motherfuckers. Felicia Michaels, Joey Diaz, Beauty and the Beast podcast, you silly motherfuckers.
Oh. Oh, you got me going on that one, Joey.
Gonna fucking send your husband out when you don't want to suck his dick. What type of shit is that shit? And that works both ways, guys. You don't want to eat your wife's fucking pussy because you don't like hair in your mouth. She's gonna go out and find a professional pussy sucker and they're gonna take her down. I.e., like me. Not the best looking guy in the world, but I've eaten pounds of fucking pussy. You understand me? Because I know a lot of guys that won't eat pussy. And if you tell a lady you eat pussy with chopsticks, they just look at you. It's a weird thing when a lady knows you're a good pussy. Yeah. They know, like, this guy's chubby. He's not good looking. You know, he's got problems. Maybe he will suck my fucking
By the
my
way, that's the thing. It's like, beautiful, handsome men have never been my thing. I like a cute guy. I like a sexy guy. But, you know, when it's too good to be true, it's like a get-rich quick scheme. You know, when someone's too beautiful, you're like, no, they ain't going to be able to throw it. You know what I mean?
Well,
like,
I see
like
girls.
A guy that just looks like he has to just,
yeah,
you
like
know,
he has
and,
to,
and, yeah, you know.
I know what you're saying, because let me give you an example. Like someone like Ariane Celeste, and I'm just using her name. She's
Who's
the
that?
UFC ring girl. Very
oh,
beautiful.
Yeah, yeah.
But I look at Ariane Celeste, and I look at her, and I'm like, she's fucking hot. And it'd be great just to look at her in bed. You probably come all over
yeah.
yourself before you attacked her. But I guarantee she's not going to grab your cock with three hands. She's not going to smear that cum on her face. She's not going to bend over and put that dick in her asshole. She's going to sit there. She's yeah. not going to want to. You know those chicks that suck dick but don't move their neck? You ever see
yeah.
those? You never see those? Like, they like sucking it, but they don't. Like, one of those. Like,
yeah.
while they're sucking your dick, you're looking at them, and you're like, really, this is the effort you're giving me? Stop.
Yeah.
Stop. Don't even worry about it. Fuck it.
But what about if we're just projecting that? Because everyone always says, like, beautiful women aren't very smart. Like, models aren't smart. What about if it's all disinformation the models are putting out there, you know, just to get people to want to be around them? Because what about if they are incredibly smart? What about if they can suck cock like a genius? You know what I mean? What about if they suck cock so good, so far back down their throat that their nose rapes their belly buttons? You know what I mean? Like, what about if they are like that? And, you know, and then that's just depressing.
No, but here's the deal. What I'm coming at is a good-looking guy
yeah.
has an ego. Okay, good. You know what kind of good-looking
yeah,
guy
yeah.
you have?
Yeah.
Ashton Kutcher. You know, there's a certain good-looking guy that you could look at, or a good-looking woman that'll tell you right now. You better get this over with. This is quick. You know, there's an ego involved. Their ego has gotten in the way of what the fuck
yeah.
the fuck is.
But come on, Ashton. Do you think Ashton and Demi Moore like have bad sex? I bet
well,
they have rotten sex.
You're not listening to me.
All right.
When Ashton Kutcher's 21, he's a good-looking guy.
Right.
And people, not even a television star. They don't even have to be a fucking television star. Just a good-looking guy in a small Iowa town.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? Those guys don't have to work for pussy. So they actually think, like, I've known guys that are really good-looking, and they get their dick sucked three times a night. Would they come back to me and say, I just ate that girl? No, because their ego is a dick.
Right.
You follow what I'm saying
okay.
to you? And women are the same. I think when a woman's really hot and you take your dick and go, suck my dick, because I had a situation 12 years ago where I was at a party and a chick was fucking smoking hot and we were doing blow. It was 7 in the morning. My flight was leaving at like 9 from Newark.
Was this in Miami?
No, this was
okay.
in Jersey. And I didn't know anything about I didn't know the girl was a freak. Nothing.
Oh, really?
She came back with blow from her boyfriend.
Really?
So it was two guys, me and this guy, and she leaves. She was at a, I had done Rascals and then went to a party and she was there and I had known her older brothers. And then she goes, I'll party with you guys. She came back to the house. He knew her. They weren't going to fuck. We were just snorting. She left, went to her boyfriend's house because he was a coke dealer, got coke and came back at like 6. I'm upstairs. She comes up and she goes, don't you want to do more coke? I said, I was trying to get an hour shut eye before this plane ride, you know? So one thing leads to another. I come back downstairs. We start doing coke again. And I tell you the truth, Felicia, I did not expect anything. I'm looking at this girl. This is 97. She is fucking beautiful.
Uh-huh.
She works in the city. She's got this boyfriend. She hangs out with these fucking guys in the city. They take her out to all these expensive dinners. She had like a $900 handbag. You know the type
right,
of woman
yeah,
I'm
yeah,
telling
yeah.
you. And we're sitting there. And my buddy had to leave to go to work. So I had to call a cab, and I'm upstairs packing. I go, I got to go upstairs and pack. I'm fucking jawing. I'm sweating. She comes upstairs right into the room, and she looks at me, and she goes, what's the first thing that comes into your mind right now? I didn't say nothing. I didn't know what she was talking about. I'm like, I don't know. And she's like, fucking doesn't come to your mind right now? And I looked at her like, look at me and look at you. That's a big difference. You're fucking beautiful. And we started swapping spits. She had like fishnet bikini on with the top, like a fishnet bra
uh-huh.
and a fishnet thing. And she took a thing off. And I'm coked up at 6 in the morning. I got dead dick. I take my little fucking turtleneck on and I go suck. And she looks at me. She goes, I'm not going to suck that. And I had to just eat her pussy. And that was it. I got on the plane and went home. But it was so weird that her ego was like, I'm not going to suck your dick. You have to fuck me. And I was really went home and thought about it. Yeah, really? Like, she was beautiful. I mean, she was fucking just torture. She was Italian, you know, the whole thing, the big nails, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I went home and I was like, wow, that's an ego chick. I've never been with, that's why I don't like him. Felicia, we did it again. Another fun-filled podcast.
Let's do a shout-out for our sponsors.
Ooh, right. Here you go. SkinIndustries.com for all your athletic apparels. Go to SkinIndustries.com and order the Beauty and the Beast t-shirt right now. Also, Adam and Eve sex toys. Go to AdamandEve.com. Order something. Press an F-E-L-I-C-I-A into the box and get an additional 10% off and free shipping. Shit.
And a bunch of presents and all that kind of stuff.
And if you have any emails or questions, you or you want to like us or don't like us, email at beautyandthebeastpodcast@gmail.com. That's beautyandthebeastpodcast@gmail.com. Felicia, thank you very much for another fun-filled week.
Yeah,
I hope we got
you,
through
Jerry.
To you guys. Next week is a holiday, and we're going to start talking to you people more about our anniversary, what we're going to be doing, and how we're going to involve you guys.
Also, I am going to be in Edmonton at the Comic Strip July 6th through the 10th. If you're in Canada around Edmonton, come on out. Is there anything you would like to discuss?
And people tweeted me again that some people bought more tickets for the house up in Minneapolis, that room.
The House of Horrors.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Okay,
yeah.
Milwaukee, Minnesota, Minneapolis. Felicia's coming, bitches. She's bringing a couple Beauty and the Beast t-shirts to go up there and see. The same thing goes for Edmonton, you cocksuckers.
All
and with
righty.
That, you sexy motherfucker. Felicia,
thanks,
I'm happy
Joey.
That your health is working out for you. I'm happy that you overcame it. I was a little worried about you. As you know, you're all I got up in the valley. So I love you, and you look beautiful. Thank you for being a part
much,
of it.
Joey.
Thank you for you guys for listening. We love you, motherfuckers. Mwah.